interesting bit coming up. It's all about Bitcoin. Mega billionaire. But first, to our lead, Bitcoin's magical summer has been coming to a crashing halt. The cryptocurrency has dropped as much as 26% since hitting an all-time high of nearly 5,000 on September 1st. Look at that fall there. The drop is due to a move, might be at least due to some moves by Chinese policymakers restricting the trading of Bitcoin and outlawing the initial coin offerings. The price has been recovered somewhat, but the cryptocurrency market as a whole has taken a hit over the past couple of weeks, knocking about $50 billion off the total market cap of all those cryptocurrencies. Earlier today on Bloomberg, New York Capital Management founder and CEO Jamie Dimon shared his thoughts about the state of the cryptocurrency market.
For Bitcoin, my old view is you can create an infinite number of cryptocurrencies, you know, if you want. If you don't have a central bank, you know, basically behind it, it's probably going to become ubiquitous and all going to go the way of, I guess, tulips.
Turn right now to talk with this, Brad Gerlinghaus, the CEO of Ripple, and Sunny Singh, BitPay's chief commercial officer. Sunny, I'm going to start with you. This move in China, first of all, the move in Bitcoin this year has backed up everything you've been telling me for the last, you know, 3 or 4 years. But then we saw this big sell-off, and you might have expected a sell-off at some point, but it's been dramatic, and it does come when this news from China comes. What do we know about Bitcoin's importance in China?
Yeah, I mean, China is definitely important to Bitcoin. China, Korea, Japan, and America are the four largest countries with Bitcoin trading. And so China...
In that order?
I think it rotates around. It changes a lot. But definitely very important. Two of the top 10 largest exchanges are in China. And so the government of China, you know, banned ICOs last week, which started the kind of downfall a little bit.
ICOs was an initial coin offering. Essentially, someone just says, hey, I got a cryptocurrency and it's worth this much, you need to buy some.
Yep, and it was kind of getting to a frenzy media hysteria in China, so the government just came in and stopped and shut it down, actually, versus regulating it. And then now what the rumor has it is they've given the Bitcoin exchanges till September 15th to shut down too as well. And that's where you saw the selling happen. And this has happened before in China where the government's forced the exchanges to shut down for a little bit. And what they do is they really start regulating more, adding more restrictions and rules to it, which is actually good for the industry, and they bring them back live again.
Brad, from your perspective, you know, and I know Ripple isn't just deals with Bitcoin a lot, but this notion of cryptocurrency, what does it mean for countries, places like China, if you could say there are other places like China, maybe not, to use these cryptocurrencies as a way to move money around and solve certain kinds of problems?
Well, I think that really is at the core. I think that when you see real-world use cases, so you can use digital assets, you can use cryptocurrency to solve real-world problems and make payments more efficient, you can make security settlement more efficient, you can make trade finance more efficient. I think to the extent you're solving a real-world problem, there's real value in those tokens, in Bitcoin.
If they're being used to buy and sell stuff, as opposed to just sort of speculate.
I very much believe that it's not just about speculation.
Okay.
I think Bitcoin increasingly has become, the use case for Bitcoin has really become the store of value. Gold historically has been a store of value, and that's a $9 trillion asset. Bitcoin is a store of value, the digital store of value, and today it's at, you know, a $65 billion asset. There's other digital assets. One of them is the one Ripple uses, XRP. We're solving a payments problem. I believe that the more utility you drive, the more demand you're going to drive. And for most of these digital assets, you have fixed supply. If you have fixed supply and increasing demand,
right,
it's going to drive price up.
And in the end, the scarcity value certainly does that if they're being put to use even more than this. They're just being speculative instruments. But I think that one of the reasons that people talk about Bitcoin stupidly, and they don't really understand what it is, so they do things like just compare it to some other currency, or has the word currency in it somewhere, and they look at it. But then this price rise in Bitcoin is sort of, in the last year really, it looks like things we've seen before. If we go on to the Bloomberg terminal, it was
because we've created a chart that actually shows this, where you can sort of look at the rise of the bubble, the bubblicious times in the NASDAQ back in April 2000. You say, huh, straight up and to the right. We've seen that before. And since I don't understand what it is, you know, Sonny, I mean, you know, I've known both of you guys since the dot-com bubble, and we've seen this. We've seen a movie like this before. Convince me, convince our viewers that this is something different.
Well, and again, I think most people know about Bitcoin because of the price rise, and they buy it, and they hold it, or speculation and all that. But what we're really having, what you're seeing, as Brad mentioned, is the pain point it's solving around the world for payments, for e-commerce, right? So at BitPay, we'll process over $1 billion this year in payments. And that's, you know, regular e-commerce merchants, but it's also businesses, actually, where it's cheaper, quicker than a wire, where a wire might take 3 days and 3% fee. We can move it for 1 day and 1% fee, let's say.
Well, I should back it up and explain really quickly what you guys do.
Yeah, so we're the largest processor of Bitcoin in the world. We allow companies like Microsoft and Newegg to accept Bitcoin, and we convert it for them and set up them fiat currency. But we also allow a lot of large global brands to have their suppliers pay them in Bitcoin around the world, from like Nigeria or Latin America, where it might be cheaper and quicker than a wire.
And I guess, you know, Brad, last time we talked on radio, Bloomberg Radio, of course, people check that out, Bloomberg Radio, bloomberg.com/audio. I encourage them to do that and check us out next on Sirius or in any of the terrestrial stations we have across the country. But you and I talked about this. We talked about the difficulty of closing Bitcoin transactions and the necessity of a fork to somehow change it, but they weren't going to accept it, yeah. The Bitcoin community. The Bitcoin community has accepted that, and that helped lead to that rise.
Well, the Bitcoin community has accepted a fork today, and there's already rumors that maybe another fork in the future. The point really that I was making then and I continue to make now is that Bitcoin isn't going to be the panacea to solve all transactions. Payments, which is something that we think about a lot at Ripple, a Bitcoin transaction takes on average 4 hours today to settle. 4 hours is a pretty long time. As Sonny's saying, it's faster than a wire transfer, but it's still not
great. Than using my Visa.
It's slower than using your Visa. I was comparing that time. XRP can transactions at 3 to 4 seconds. So it's a much more fluid system. Just to comment briefly on your comparing the bubble, if you don't mind. I think that there are things that we could point to and say, oh, well, you know, this market has been volatile. A lot of things have changed. But I also think it's very, very different. You know, I remember, because we've both been following this world for a long time, the Newsweek had a cover story about how the Internet was overhyped and the Internet was going to fail. Literally, the Internet is going to fail. Jamie Dimon coming out and saying that Bitcoin is a fraud, to me, it's like the Newsweek cover. This is Newsweek, I don't think, really understood. I mean, if you look at where the Internet is today and how much advancement has happened and how much has permeated our entire lives, I think there's aspects of what's happening in digital assets, there's aspects of what's happening in blockchain that are going to permeate our lives much more broadly than people can embrace. I think
let me add to Jim Davidson. Bitcoin, on some level, is completely in competition with the business that Jamie Dimon has.
Absolutely.
Recording transactions, being a middleman, being on both sides of a trade, and taking a VIG. Cryptocurrency takes a lot of that business away. And so if you were a Jamie Dimon or if you were a Lloyd Blankfein, you might be concerned about cryptocurrencies being accepted in the markets.
Look, I think there's a lot of truth to that. I think it's easy for Jamie Dimon to come out and talk about that. If I were a shareholder in JP Morgan, I'd be glad that he's out there doing that, because it's in his best interest to protect the establishment. There's an oligopoly that's managing. He sits on top of that oligopoly in terms of how the payments work today. But most banks actually don't want to see that happen. And you see very innovative banks. Standard Chartered is an early customer of Ripple and leaning in aggressively. Santander. So there's a lot of banks that are not putting their head in the sand.
And UPS. UPS.
Put their head in the sand. They could have been Netflix. Right. If you think about it, they had the relationships with customers. They had the relationships with movie studios. But they put their head in the sand about what the future of the Internet was going to enable. And now they're gone. And Netflix obviously is a very valuable company.
Yeah, you see all the banks reaching out to companies like us and Ripple and all that, wanting to partner up. And even though Jamie is saying those things, his internal team is actually working with our companies to do pilots and trying to figure out how to leverage this technology.
It does seem like he knows on one level what he's talking about, and maybe that's why he's saying what he's saying. Go figure. Sonny Singh, so good to see you.
It's always a pleasure.